Good afternoon, everyone. So I welcome you all to the session. I welcome the judges of this session, Dr. Pankaj Shah, a well-known ophthalmologist from Jalgaon, Professor Dr. Praveena Kher, madam. She is a professor at Jawaharlal Nehru Medical College, Savangi. And Dr. Harsh Mamidwar, unfortunately, he is not here. He couldn't join the meeting. So I got call from Secretary Moss that I will be a moderator and the third judge also. So I invite our first speaker, Dr. Akanksha Pandit, whether she is here.
Hello, good evening, sir. Yes, I'm
yes,
here.
Yes, Dr. Akanksha, your topic is, I think, a study of neuro-ophthalmic manifestations of stroke in a tertiary rural hospital.
Yes, sir.
Are you ready with your topic?
Yes, sir. I'll share my screen.
Yes. Actually, I would like to request all our speakers and judges also that we are running 20 minutes late. So finish it in with time so that we can hand over our next session to the next moderator. Okay.
Thank you, Siddharth. Good evening, everybody. Thank you to all the judges and the participants. Good evening, Praveena, ma'am.
Good evening, ma'am. Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening, Ragini, madam. How are you?
I am only Ragini for you. Yes, thank you, ma'am. Fine, thank you so much, ma'am. Yes. Sorry for the interruption. I just wanted to say hi to everybody. Hi, Pankaj.
Good evening, ma'am. Madam, mute, sir.
Thank you, Saili. Thank you. Good evening. Siddharth, please.
Yes, madam.
Good evening.
Good evening, madam. Yes, madam. So, shall we start, madam? Yes, Dr. Akanksha, go ahead.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Akanksha Pandit. I'm presenting a study of neuro-ophthalmic manifestation of a stroke in a tertiary rural hospital. Stroke or cerebrovascular accident refers to a clinical syndrome of vascular origin characterized by rapidly developing focal or global disturbances. It is of two types, ischemic or hemorrhagic. A large portion of the central nervous system is dedicated to vision. Therefore, stroke have a high likelihood of involving vision in some or the other way. Vascular occlusion along the afferent or efferent visual pathway can produce myriad of effects, including transient monocular vision loss, visual field defects, ocular dysmotility, and various other effects. All these manifestations can provide assistance in roughly localizing the site of brain lesion and stroke. Hello? Hello?
Yes, Dr. Akanksha.
Sir, my screen has stopped sharing, like it's not going ahead. Okay.
Yes, it's going.
The aim of my study is to study the various ocular manifestations in patient of CVA coming to Pravara Rural Hospital, Loni. The material and methodology used was descriptive cross-sectional study in the diagnosed case of cerebrovascular accident in around 50 patients. The patient who are giving consent and undergone CT and MRI scan and diagnosed patients of CVA in the general medicine ward and referred to the Department of Ophthalmology were included in the study. While the patients who were unconscious, had ocular trauma, eyeball disfigurement, or patient with infective CNS conditions were excluded. Patients with Glasgow Coma Scale score greater than 8 were examined thoroughly using a preformed questionnaire. A detailed ophthalmic examination including visual acuity, ocular movements, visual field, slit lamp examination, detailed fundus examination, cranial nerve assessment were performed. CT and MRI reports were noted. Coming to the results, out of 50 patients, 78% were male and 22% patients were female. Mean age of occurrence was 56.5 years and venous stroke was noted in young patients. Patients were divided according to arterial and venous stroke. 92% patients were having arterial stroke while 8% had venous stroke. Arterial stroke patients were further divided as ischemic arterial stroke in 80.43 patients while hemorrhagic stroke was seen in 19.57% patients. coming to the blood territory affected, middle cerebral artery territory had an involvement of 64.10%, which was maximum, while second one with 40% was a posterior cerebral artery involvement. The patients with MCA territory stroke presented with eyes deviated to the side of lesion were 40%, and contralateral homonymous hemianopia was seen in 60% patient. The posterior cerebral artery stroke was seen in involvement in case of bilateral paramedian thalamic infarct, vertical gaze palsy was seen, thalamic plus occipital infarct, contralateral homonymous hemianopia with sparing of macula, while the midbrain infarct patient presented with ipsilateral third nerve palsy, fixed dilated pupil and ptosis. The mixed territory patient presented with contralateral homonymous hemianopia and contralateral visual neglect, while the basilar artery infarct patient presented with sixth nerve along with the seventh nerve involvement and ipsilateral internuclear ophthalmoplegia was also seen. Coming to the hemorrhagic arterial stroke, in case of ganglioclapsular bleed, eyes were deviated towards the side of lesion in every patient, while ipsilateral dilated pupil was seen in 40% patients. Parietotemporal lobar hemorrhage patients presented with eyes deviated towards the side of lesion. Subarachnoid hemorrhage patients presented with third nerve palsy with ipsilateral dilated pupil and papular edema. Posterolateral thalamic hemorrhage patients presented with skewed deviation and non-reacting pupil. Pontine hemorrhagic patients presented with pinpoint pupils and dorsal reflex was absent. In case of penis stroke, around 4 patients in the age group of 31 to 40 years were noted and female preponderance was seen. MCA territory was most commonly involved and patients presented with sixth nerve palsy, gaze preference to ipsilateral side and papular edema was present in all the 4 cases. Coming to the fundus findings, About 62% patient had retinal vascular abnormalities. In that, 83.87% patient had hypertensive retinopathy, while 66.6% patient had diabetic retinopathy. Coming to the discussion, in my study, I found male predilection, and it similar was found in a study done by Vishna J.P. et al. MCA territory was the most commonly affected territory. It was also found in a study conducted by E. Seen and J. Joelsten et al. The most common form of visual field loss was found to be homonymous hemianopia, and vertical gaze palsy was most common motility disorder. Out of the 50 patients, 88% patients presented with ocular findings, 68% presented with homonymous hemianopia, 12% with vertical gaze palsy, and horizontal gaze palsy, ptosis, and restriction of movements were seen in 4% patients. Diplopia was seen in 10% patients and cortical blindness in 2 patients. A very similar study conducted by Fiona J. Rowe and Vis Al also produced the same reports. In venous stroke, young females were most commonly affected and all 4 patients had papular edema. A prospective study conducted by Hossein Azin et al. Also produced a result of 82.3% patients with papular edema and cranial nerve involvement noted in 31.1% patients. Thus concluding that a significant number of patients of stroke have ocular findings which help in localizing the site of stroke. Ocular examination should therefore not be neglected, and as an early intervention can help in a better visual rehabilitation. These are my references. Thank you.
Yes, Akanksha, can you tell me what are the different manifestations that occurred mainly in arterial or in the venous stroke? How we can define that, how we can diagnose that it is a arterial or the venous stroke?
Ma'am, first of all, in case of arterial stroke, the area involved, like the ischemic, it was divided as ischemic and hemorrhagic. So in case of ischemic strokes, the area, like the territory, I classified them as territory, like middle cerebral artery territory, posterior cerebral artery territory. So in case of middle cerebral artery territory, whenever the lesion were restricted to ganglio-capsular region or the midbrain region, or parietotemporal region, that time the eyes were deviated to the side of lesion. And most commonly, I could find there was contralateral homonymous hemianopia. More specifically, whenever there was midbrain lesion, that time I could find that there were third nerve involvement was seen in around 70% patients. Then coming to the posterior cerebral artery stroke, in this case, the ganglio-capsular lesion was involved. In that case, vertical gaze palsy can be seen, or the skewed eye deviation can be seen. Then in case of, if we come to the venous stroke, I found that it was mostly common in younger age group and female preponderance was seen. And in this case, the sinuses was involved. So inevitably, papilloedema was seen in almost 100% patients, while sixth nerve affection was also seen in 2 patients and ipsilateral gaze palsy was also seen.
Okay.
Nice. So any other questions from judges or should we go ahead?
One more question that you have not divided categorically the visual symptoms as such. That should have been supposedly the vision, the ocular motility, the ocular visual perceptions, that is spatial perceptions and all that, those things should have been divided. I feel that way. That should have been done.
Okay, ma'am. Yes, I did it according to the territory rather than according to the visual symptoms.
Yes, but yes. They are correlating. If you if you see for the symptoms, definitely you can get the area which is being affected.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
That is all together. You should have just made a chart out of it that these are the symptoms, the vision, and then again the area which is being involved. Like just talked about the cortical blindness and all that. So that should have been mentioned in a chart. That should have been another chart which should have been mentioned over there.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Well, thank you, Dr. Akanksha.
Thank you, sir.
So next speaker is Dr. Sarita Kagde. Dr. Sarita, are you there? Dr. Sarita Kagde, whether she's there. Okay, we will move on to next speaker, Dr. Prachi.
Yes, I'm there.
Yes, Dr. Prachi, I think your topic is effectiveness of Hayden suture to control dissociated horizontal deviation.
Is my screen being seen?
Yes, yes. Make it full screen and go ahead, Dr. Prachi.
Very good afternoon, judges and moderators. So I'm going to present my paper on effectiveness of Hayden suture to control dissociated horizontal deviation. So DHD or dissociated horizontal deviation is a horizontal component of the dissociated strabismus complex, which also has a vertical and a torsional component. The exotropic form is a common one, as is seen in the video, wherein if you can see the right eye, it deviates a lot under the cover as compared to the left eye. Esotropic form is less common. It is reported commonly after surgery for infantile esotropia as a cause of exotropia. So the aim of the study was to report the results of use of posterior fixation suture, Hayden suture, on the horizontal rectus for control of DHD. It was a retrospective study. 5 patients with DHD who had undergone the procedure were included. DHD was diagnosed on the basis of the positive reverse fixation test depicted in the video. So in the prism cover test, we see an abducting saccade in the right eye while an adducting movement is seen on the eye under the prism, which is diagnostic of DHD. Patients with a minimum follow-up of 1 year were included. Exclusion criteria, any patients with high AC by A ratio or any other cause of asymmetric deviation. So this is a pre-operative chart of the included patients with the age range between 5 to 12 years. If you look at the vision, the eyes that had the DHD had suboptimal vision ranging between, say, 660 to, say, around 680. four patients had a primary deviation as exotropia, while one patient has a primary deviation as esotropia. This is the chart of the DHG, which mentions the amount of DHG that was present. The eye on DHG underwent a rectus muscle recession along with Fadden. Also of note, all these eyes which had DHG had suppression on BSV testing. The surgical procedure was carried out through a limbal approach, wherein the horizontal rectus muscle was isolated as usual. A non-absorbable 5-0 polyester suture was taken 17 millimeters behind the insertion for lateral rectus and 14 millimeters behind the insertion for medial rectus on the sclera. The desired recession process on the procedure on the rectus muscle was done, and then the sutures were brought out from the upper and lower third of the muscles and were tied in the center. Coming to the results, the patients were followed up to note the improvement in the horizontal drift post-operatively. So the average follow-up that was there was around 15.6 months. We got a good correction of the DHG, which I'll show in the next chart. Of note was also that two patients developed fusion post-surgery, while others continued to have suppression. So the average DHG correction that was obtained was from 16.6 prism diopters to 2.2 prism diopters post-operatively. Also, over the long-term period, there was no restriction in ocular motility that was noted in these patients. I would present two cases to just try and convey what the result was actually giving us. So this is a six-year-old female presenting with squinting of the right eye with the suboptimal vision in the right eye. The deviation was around 30 to 35 prisms of exotropia with DHG measuring 18 prism diopters. The patient underwent a surgery of lateral rectus recession of 7 mm with medial rectus resection of 5 mm with Fadden of the lateral rectus. So these are the serial videos showing the correction that was obtained. There's a pre-op deviation, the eye, right eye drifting out. This is the patient at 1 month post-op. Just notice the deviation of the right eye under cover, which is hardly deviated. And that is the same patient 3 years post-operatively, where a small DVD in the right eye is being manifested, but the horizontal deviation is well corrected. This is the second case of a 10-year-old male who presented with diminished vision in the left eye. He had been patching the right eye for the last 2 years. Right eye vision was 6.9, left eye was 6.24. The primary deviation was 16 prisms of esotropia. Again, note that there is a deviation, inward deviation of the eye under the cover. When the patient used to fixate at distance, the left eye used to drift inwards, and the DHG measured approximately 25 prism diopters. The patient underwent a medial rectus recession of 4.5 millimeters with a Fadden on the medial rectus. These are the concurrent photographs depicting the 1 year post-operative result. We can see that the esotropia is well corrected. The drift, horizontal drift is well corrected. A small DVD is manifest under cover. And this is the drift that was there on fixation, which now is completely corrected and a small DVD is being manifested. Coming to the discussion, Rav in 1987 first recommended this procedure for DHG. Good results had also been reported in 12 patients in a very old paper from Spain. A major paper of reporting outcome of 33 patients has mainly been in the form of lateral rectus recession. So I would like to bring it to the notice that most of the management options that are suggested for DHG are in the form of variable measurements of lateral rectus recession. In this paper, 75% patients had already undergone a surgery for infantile esotropia. They did two or three procedures for control of DHG using various measures of lateral rectus recession, and residual DHG was still present in 30% of the patients. There's another study from China where they studied patients of DHG using augmented lateral rectus recession, where they did suggest PFS for DHG for when it was more than 30 prism diopters. However, though in our study we had lesser amounts of DHG, we did get a good control. The last second case that I presented was the uncommon form of an eso drift of DHG that has been reported by Spielman, where again a Fadden of the medial rectus muscle was suggested for this entity, and that corresponding to this, we also got a good result in our patient. So to conclude, the posterior fixation suture on the lateral rectus for exotropic form of DHG and on the medial rectus for esotropic form of DHG seems to provide good long-term control in cases of dissociated horizontal deviation. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Prachi. Judges, any question?
Yes, I have first one basic question is, what is dissociated horizontal deviation? That is how we define it basically. Dissociated horizontal deviation, how we define it basically, so that we should know the text. If we know the exact anatomy of this particular situation.
You are muted, Dr. Prachi.
Hello, am I audible?
Yeah.
So,
not audible.
See more commonly across in the squint patients. This is similar, but in the horizontal form. So that is what is DHE. So it is not just plain exotropia. Normally in exotropia, we would get a comitant deviation. Here we see, like we put a prism on each eye to control the deviation. On measurement, if one eye is neutralized by 30, the other eye will be neutralized by 50. So that is how we get the amount of DHD basically.
It is unrelated to accommodation, I believe.
Unrelated to accommodation or paresis or any weakness.
Right. It is solely because of the change in the balance of the visual input from the two eyes. That is
correct.
The basic.
Correct. Yes.
Good. Any more questions? So shall we proceed? Thank you, Dr. Prachi. It was nice.
Okay, thank you.
It was a nice presentation. Good.
Thank you, sir.
So, next speaker is Dr. Vaishnavi Vankhede.
Yes, sir.
Vaishnavi, are you there? Yeah. I think your topic is double trouble in patient with normal ocular movements.
Yes, right? Sir. Yes. Yes, sir.
Yes. Share your screen.
So am I audible?
Yes, go ahead, Dr. Vaishnavi.
Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm going to present a study on double trouble in patients with normal ocular movements, a case series. So diplopia is derived from a Greek word that is diplopus and ops, which means double an eye, and is referred as a single object is possessive as two. On the basis of constancy, it is divided into constant or intermittent diplopia. On the basis of direction, it can be horizontal, vertical, or diagonal diplopia. And on the basis of eye involved, it can be monocular or binocular diplopia. So some of the causes of monocular diplopia includes uncorrected refractive errors, immature cataract, dry eye syndrome, wrong fitting contact lens, irregular corneal surface, keratoconus, and abnormalities of the iris. And some of the causes of binocular diplopia includes paralytic squint, restrictive squint, neurological or brainstem disorder. So binocular diplopia mostly occurs in patients having limitations of the ocular movements, but can rarely be present in patients having normal ocular movements. So patients with binocular diplopia can be mistaken to be malingering, and a more serious cause may be hence missed or diagnosed late. So the purpose of my study is to find out the causes of diplopia in patients with normal ocular movements attending ophthalmology OPD in tertiary healthcare center. So for this, a retrospective study was done on 8 patients complaining of diplopia with normal ocular movements visiting ophthalmology OPD in tertiary healthcare center conducted in July and August 2021. So the evaluation of patient was done in following manner. The visual acuity assessment was done on this Slenin's chart. Then differentiation between monocular and binocular diplopia was done. Then squint evaluation of the patient was done, which includes cover or uncover test, prism cover test for near and distance, detailed ocular movement examination, including vergence, ductions, and vergences were examined and followed by diplopia charting. So my study included 8 patients. Among them, 4 were found to be male and 4 were females. And about 50% of patients were seen between 10 to 19 years of age group, and 50% found to be between 20 to 29 years of age group. So the mean age of presentation in my study was 19.5 years. So, and of this, all the patients presented with binocular diplopia. Of them, 5 patients presented with intermittent diplopia, and 5 showed and 3 showed constant diplopia. Coming to the causes, intermittent exotropia was seen in 4 patients. acute acquired comitant esotropia was seen in 3 patients and spasm of near reflex was found in 1 patient. The patient of intermittent exotropia complained only of momentary diplopia, which they could control once they became aware of it. On the basis of the type of intermittent exotropia, 4 patients presented with basic type of intermittent exotropia, and on the type of acute acquired comitant esotropia, 2 patients presented with type 2 and 1 patient presented with type 5 acute acquired comitant esotropia. So, diplopia mostly presents with limitation of ocular movements, but here in our cases, it also presented with full and free ocular movements. The causes for diplopia in full and free ocular movements were found to be acute acquired comitant esotropia, intermittent exotropia, and spasm for near reflex. In our study, 4 patients presented with intermittent exotropia with complaint of intermittent diplopia. Intermittent exotropia is a large chorea that is intermittently controlled by fusional convergence. Hence, the patient have binocular single vision, but in case of stress and fatigue, insufficiency in the convergence occurs and thus manifests the deviation in such condition. Patient may complain of diplopia when deviation is manifest. Hult et al. In 2016 study showed 29% children with intermittent exotropia reported with diplopia. Pratt Johnson's and V 1969 and Nurse et al. 2006 study showed the similar presentation. Acute acquired comitant esotropia is a rare disease that occurs in around 0.3% of the children with strabismus. In our study, 3 patients presented with acute acquired comitant esotropia. Amongst them, 2 patients were of type 2 and 1 was of type 5 acute acquired comitant esotropia, having sagittal sinus thrombosis. Lux et al. Found that 30% of the 30 patients with acute acquired comitant esotropia had type 2 A's, whereas Bush and Windings had 19 patients with type 2 acute acquired comitant esotropia in their study of 48 patients. Type 5 acute acquired comitant esotropia was rare in both the above studies. Lux et al. 1 was found in 30 patients and Bush and Windings 30 in 48 patients. Now, spasm of near reflex is characterized by intermittent and variable attack of convergence, accommodative spasm, and meiosis. In our study, 1 patient presented with spasm of near reflex. It manifests with symptoms of sudden onset blurring of vision with or without diplopia. Diplopia in patients with normal ocular movements is usually monocular type, but we present a series of 8 patients with binocular diplopia and normal ocular movements. So the conclusion of my study is presence of diplopia in a patient with full and free ocular movements can create a diagnostic dilemma. A thorough evaluation can diagnose the rare cause of diplopia and provide appropriate management. Care should be taken to do careful evaluation and not attribute diplopia in a presence of full and free ocular movements to malignant. These are some of my references. Thank you.
Yes, Vaishnavi, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
You talked about double trouble, right? So, yes. And most of the cases that you have taken in the study are binocular diplopia. You all talked about binocular diplopia. You were talking about the acute acquired. This was the most of the time you talked about acute acquired. What can be the other causes which can be related to a normal ocular movement with binocular diplopia?
Ma'am, it can be paralytic squint, or patient can have divergent squint also, or without, it can have
without any paralysis.
Ma'am, any brainstem disorder.
But that will lead to neurological cause. That will lead to a paralytic type of squint. No, we want to know about the causes which is with normal eye movement. You are talking about the with normal eye movement plus the patient is presenting with binocular diplopia, right? This is what you have mentioned about in all the cases. So can you think any other case where you have a binocular diplopia though there is a normal ocular movement? Which case you can have such thing?
I mean, like in spasm for near reflex also.
Spasm you have already mentioned. What other thing can be there? Myasthenia gravis? What happens?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Neuromuscular disorder, myasthenia, even in botulism toxicity, they can present. Yes,
that can be there, but yes, you should have mentioned those things.
Yes, ma'am.
They have
the muscular dysfunction.
Yes, they have normal. There is normal ocular movement. Still, the patient talks of diplopia. That can happen.
Yes,
right?
Ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you, Vaishnavi.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Vaishnavi. Next presenter is Dr. S. Babu Vinci. Are you ready?
Hello, am I audible, sir?
Yes, yes. I think your topic is conjunctival lymphoma.
K-series.
A series of three patients. No?
Yes, sir.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay, sir. Good evening, everyone. Sorry, wait a minute. Good evening, everyone. I will be presenting a case series on the topic conjunctival lymphoma. I have no financial interest in this topic. Redness of eye is a common presentation. Redness of eye is a common presentation for various ophthalmological conditions, but it can also represent certain uncommon serious conditions. Here I'm presenting three cases of red eye with uncommon diagnosis. Case number one, 59-year-old male patient presented to OPD with complaints of redness, protrusion of eye, and diminution of vision in left eye since 6 months. He has been treated as a case of scleritis for the past 1 month with topical steroids, but didn't get improved. On examination, his vision in left eye was PL positive, with conjunctiva showing severe chemosis as well as congestion. Press anterior segment was normal, with fundus examination showed a closed funnel RD. We have done a CT brain plus orbit for this patient in view of proptosis, which was suggestive of a hyperechoic mass over the left conjunctival region, suggestive of lymphoma. On the basis of the CT report, we did a conjunctival biopsy for this patient that confirmed the diagnosis of extranodal marginal zone lymphoma. To rule out any other systemic lymphoma, we did a bone marrow biopsy as well as CSF analysis for the patient, which was completely normal. And PET scan was also normal with the patient, and the patient has been treated with external beam radiotherapy. 6 month follow-up for this patient was run. The patient has a good prognosis. Second case, a 59-year-old patient presented to OPD with complaints of sudden onset redness, blurring of vision, and irritation in his left eye since 1 month. He was also been diagnosed as episcleritis and treated with topical NSAIDs, but didn't get improved. On examination, his vision in left eye was found to be 6/18, with conjunctiva showing severe chemosis as well as congestion. There was a Salmon patch appearance, whereas anterior segment examination as well as posterior segment examination was normal. CT brain plus orbit was also was done for this patient also, which was suggestive of lymphoma. On the basis of the CT report, we again did a conjunctival biopsy. Histopathology confirmed the diagnosis of follicular lymphoma. To rule out the systemic lymphomas, we did bone marrow biopsy as well as CSF analysis. CSF analysis of the second patient was found to be normal, but bone marrow biopsy confirmed lymphoma. PET scan also was suggestive of weakly metabolic right level 6 cervical lymph nodes. He has been treated with 6 cycles of chemotherapy, that is CVP regimen, intravenous cyclophosphamide plus vincristine plus prednisolone, along with external beam radiotherapy. And the third patient was a 63-year-old man presented with complaints of redness and a painless progressive mass and protrusion of left eye since 1 month. He was treated as nodular scleritis for 1 month with topical steroids. On examination, left eye showed mild proptosis with vision of 6/18, and there was a mass over the bulbar conjunctiva. Res anterior segment as well as posterior segment examination of the patient was normal. CT again showed a hyperechoic mass of the conjunctiva, suggestive of lymphoma. Biopsy again was performed for this patient, which confirmed a diagnosis of extranodal marginal zone lymphoma. Here in this patient, bone marrow biopsy showed features of lymphoma along with minimal involvement. CSF analysis also showed abnormal lymphocytes. PET scan showed metabolically active lesion in left orbit as well as right lumbar region with mesenteric lymph nodes, which was neoplastic. And he has been treated with IV chemotherapy, CHOP regimen, cyclophosphamide, doxorubicin, vincristine plus prednisolone, along with a course of radiotherapy. Here also 6 monthly, the patient was followed. Patient has a good prognosis. And coming to the discussion part, lymphoma is a malignant lymphoproliferative tumors. 5 to 15% of all the lymphoma occurs in ocular adnexal areas. And among the ocular adnexal region, conjunctiva is the most common site for lymphoma. And conjunctival lymphoma can again be classified into low grade as well as high grade. And low grade includes extranodal marginal zone lymphoma as well as follicular lymphoma. And high grade conjunctival lymphoma includes diffuse large B-cell lymphoma as well as mantle cell lymphoma. And again, here I'm presenting a Shield et al. Conducted a study on the topic, epidemiology of histological subtypes of conjunctival lymphoma. He found out that mean age for conjunctival lymphoma is around 60 to 70 years, with maximally the presentation was of low-grade conjunctival lymphoma. And among the low-grade conjunctival lymphoma, extranodal marginal zone lymphoma was found to be more. 80% of the patients was having extranodal marginal zone lymphoma. And among in this case series also, all the three patients were of the mean age group 60 years, and all the three had low-grade conjunctival lymphoma only. And out of the three, two were diagnosed to have extranodal marginal zone lymphoma. So coming to the conclusion, clinical features of conjunctival lymphomas are non-specific, so it is crucial to obtain biopsies and further immunochemistry. Treatment of conjunctival lymphoma is determined by the stage and extent of the disease. These are my references. Thank you.
Yes, Ms. Vinci, when I saw your two pictures, you mentioned there is a severe chemosis, but I am not finding chemosis in those two cases. Was it being treated?
What, ma'am?
Your two pictures, the initial two pictures of the cases, they don't show much of the chemosis, whereas you have mentioned that there is severe chemosis in all the three eyes. That you have mentioned about, but I did not see much of a chemosis. Was they being treated?
Yes, ma'am. They have been treated with topical steroids.
They were being treated with steroids.
Steroids, yes, ma'am. Topical steroids have been given for actually 1 month for the first patient.
Okay, so that's why we don't see that thing.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. What are the differential diagnoses you have put to before diagnosing it to be a lymphoma, conjunctival lymphoma? Yes,
we first suspected as scleritis and episcleritis only, and then the patient didn't get improved, and we did a CT. You know, then we suspected an OSS and can be a differential diagnosis for the third patient, as there was a mass over the superior bulbar conjunctiva. Then. Yeah.
Any epithelial inclusion mass can also show like that.
A benign reactive lymphoid hyperplasia can be a chance, and again, squamous papilloma and all benign ocular surface tumors can also present like that.
Okay. Because you did not mention that you suggested, because you only suggested that there are only scleritis and episcleritis they were being. Thought of, that they have been thought of. But I think that these should also have been included in your differential diagnosis. I believe that way.
Yes, ma'am.
Whether these three patients having some other systemic disorders along with or only ocular manifestations?
They only presented with ocular manifestation. They didn't have any other systemic the illness and all.
Okay. So there is a non-healing recurrent long-standing episcleritis that made you think of another diagnosis should be there, no?
As the patient developed proptosis later on, that is first follow-up, and the patient didn't have proptosis. Later on, he developed proptosis. That's why we performed a CT for the patient.
Okay.
As proptosis is not a common finding in scleritis and episcleritis, we suspected something intraocular mass or something, and that's why we performed a CT.
Okay. And whether there was a difference between the outcome of early intervention or early diagnosis?
Yes, sorry. For early intervention, if it is only involving orbit, then extra EBRT say there is 90% remission out there. That is 90%. There is a chance for 90% remission if you are treating. That is if there is only orbital involvement. If other systemic in yes, ma'am.
What is MAL type of lymphoma?
MAL is extranodal marginal zone lymphoma only, ma'am.
Extranodal marginal
zone lymphoma.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Vinci.
Thanks.
That was nice.
Thanks.
Okay, so our next presenter is Dr. Reshma Mehta.
Yes, sir.
Yes, I think your topic is vision improvement with orthoptic exercise in child with macular dystrophy.
Yes, sir.
Yes, madam, go ahead.
Good afternoon, everyone. I thank the scientific committee and the managing committee of MOS to give me this opportunity to present my case of orthoptic exercises over here. My title is Vision Improvement with Orthoptic Exercise in a Child with Macular Dystrophy.
Madam, make it a full screen and...
Okay, sir.
Yes.
Progressive cone dystrophies are clinically and genetically heterogeneous group of inherited retinal diseases characterized by cone photoreceptor degeneration, which presents with progressive loss of central vision and photophobia. A case of 6-year-old male child was brought by his mother, who presented with decrease in vision, which was progressive in nature and associated with photophobia. On systemic history, there was nothing significant. On ocular examination, the visual acuity patient had finger counting 3 meters. He could see only up to 3 meters, and after cycloplegic refraction, found -2.5 at 10 degrees and -3 at 20 degrees, myopic astigmatism, and improved to 660. Otherwise, his anterior segment examination was normal, but his fundus examination showed bullseye maculopathy. Color vision was also abnormal. OCT was done and OCT showed structural abnormality in the retinal layers. ERG was not done as not available in our town. The family history showed that patient was the second product of the second degree consanguineous marriage. Diagnosis of macular dystrophy was made, and then the patient was given a trial of low vision aids, but there was no improvement in vision. So we tried on giving orthoptic exercises to this patient. He was given orthoptic exercises for 15 days with 2 sessions every day. Each session lasted for 45 minutes. And there was drastic improvement in his vision from 660 to 680. Also, his near vision improved from N12 to N8, N6. The patient had achieved steady central gaze. There was improvement in his spatial recognition, and the uprolling of eyeballs had decreased, though no improvement in color vision seen. The patient's mother was very happy to tell that he could pick up objects which were fallen on the ground. Earlier, he had to feel them and then pick them up. Also, she was very happy to say that he could identify his friends passing by the window, which previously he could not, and was always aloof and alone. So they were very happy for this drastic improvement in vision, which was very surprising. So we take a look at what orthoptic exercises and the mechanism behind improvement of vision. So this is a chart, a screen, which is kept at 3 feet away from the patient. And the red light shines in the center, and the peripheral white light comes after every 300 milliseconds. The laser green light is given in the hand of the patient for a better eye-hand coordination. The patient is asked to fix at the red light, and the patient is asked to look at the white light when it appears and move the laser light according to the movement of the white light whenever it is appearing. So the red light is in the center, and the white light, which lasts for 300 milliseconds, and again it disappears for 300 milliseconds. The white light shines for 200 times and in and then it stimulates the covert attention area and the V1 area in the visual cortex. Now we'll try and understand how this works. So we have the retinal cells, that is the photoreceptors, which the light energy is converted to neural energy through the ganglion cells, the parvo and the magno cells. The parvo cells, which are located in the central retina, and the magno cells, which are located in the peripheral retina. From here, they travel to the lateral geniculate body. Then in the lateral geniculate body, again, they are represented from V1, from areas 1 to 6. Later, these impulses are transmitted to the visual cortex, where they are again represented in the area V4, C beta, and V4, C alpha, the parvo cells and the magno cells. So the impulses from the retina travel to the cortex through the lateral geniculate body, which is very complex. And again, from the visual cortex, they travel back to the lateral geniculate body, which are known as the top-down impulses. So these impulses then are sent to the primary, to the posterior parietal cortex. Now the parietal cortex is the global sensory motor integrated center. Because we have the brain, which is anterior part, which is the motor and the sensory part in the posterior part of the brain, so which is controlled. So this control basically is integrated part in the parietal cortex. Now this posterior parietal cortex also has attention area, and the saccadic area is represented in the same way as the retina is represented. That is, the nasal part of the fovea and the temporal part of the fovea is represented in the same way in this posterior parietal cortex, in the parvocellular pathway and the magnocellular pathway. So the principle of this orthoptic machine is there is sudden appearance of the light, the white light, which stimulates the saccadic movement. This saccadic movement, again, it stimulates the fovea, which in turn stimulates the V1 area. And then via the top-down impulses, there is stimulation in the posterior parietal cortex and suppression of the retinal area between the fovea and the peripherally stimulated retinal points. Later, this repeated stimulation of the magnocellular cells, that is the peripheral retinal area, it stimulates the attention area and the peripheral area and in turn stimulates the fovea. So because of number of times stimulating the fovea, there is increase in his vision. Now we have a lot of movements of the eye, that is saccades, prosaccades, pursuits, convergence movement, divergence movement. But prosaccades are associated with maximum stimulation of the V1 area of the visual cortex and the posterior parietal cortex. So this is a picture which shows the boy who had uprolling of eyeballs and had photosensitivity, which after 15 sessions of this orthoptic exercise, the photophobia decreased and also the uprolling of his eyeballs decreased. We have references from Dr. Santan Gopal, Dr. Chitra Jayade, and IGO, that is Dr. Zai Kekar, also has a similar study. So this is a picture again depicting the impulses transmitted from the retina to the LGN, to the visual cortex, from V1 to V6, and again to the posterior parietal cortex. Thank you.
Screen share. Yes, Dr. Reshma, just how much time was taken to stimulate this and to have increase the vision from say about 660 to 680, like that you have mentioned?
Ma'am, the patient did 15 sessions, and that is 15 days every day, almost 45 minutes in the morning and 45 minutes in the evening. He was asked to do the stimulation exercises for 45 minutes each for 15 days. And after 15 days, we reduced it to once a week. And so after a month, the patient realized that yes, there is definite improvement in his vision.
So how often you were calling the patient?
Every day for 15 days and then once a week for last 15 days.
Okay, that that instrument was with you, so that he was to call
yes.
his that. That
yes, was, yes, 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 yes.
Did any parents did find anything change every day when they came back?
Yes, immediately after first two or three sessions, there was a sudden improvement in his photosensitivity. There was decrease, and his photophobia had decreased, his nystagmus had decreased, and they said he could pick up objects or he could identify objects easily, but his distant vision improved a little later.
At what age it was more defined?
6 years. The patient is 6 years old. So he was able to hold the laser light properly and his hand-eye coordination was good. And we asked the child to sit in the mother's lap.
And what do you think, what is the maximum age that so that it will benefit for children?
Almost we have had many children up to 12 years of age, exotropia patients, insufficiency, convergence insufficiency patients, intermittent diversion squints. But latest, we have had a 30-year-old dentist who had intermittent exotropia, almost 30 prism XT exotropia. And he had photophobia also, and he had problem of driving at night. So we asked him, see, you are an adult and we are giving this treatment for children, but if you want, we can try. So he tried and there was phenomenal improvement. He basically belongs to another city. And so he had to travel to my place. So we would do it only twice a week on Saturday, Sundays. But he said, when he went back to Pune for a week, he said, at night my driving improved and I never had diplopia or blurring of vision. Always he would have a lot of blurring of vision when he had to travel at night and drive. So because of that intermittent divergence, when his eye would divert, there was blurring and he had to squeeze his eye and he said, I had diplopia and could not see properly. But after 3 to 4 sessions, his photophobia also improved and his intermittent divergence squint has reduced from 30 prisms to almost 18 prisms. And his near convergence also improved. He said, now when we do his near convergence test on the letter chart, on the letters, he said, now I am not able to see them double. I can see them. He could read it clearly. So for him also, it was like a miracle. And basically, he belonged to an ophthalmologist's son. So we were more worried.
And what is the minimum age of the child on which you have performed this orthoptic exercise?
5 years, because they should be able to sit and look at the distant object, which is 3 meters away.
Okay.
But it is showing a lot of good results, especially in children with amblyopia and exotropias. We have had children coming because basically it was lockdown, so they had a lot of time and they were not ready for surgeries. So they used to come and sit and do it as a play game or a computer game. So we have had a lot of squints which have reduced. So there were patients where plus five diaptosphere hypermetropes with exotropias. The plus five was given, but patching, the patients were not improving with patching. But his exotropia has completely gone after orthoptic exercise. But his plus five is still there. Like hypermetropic glasses are continuing, but his exotropia has reduced for a 7-year-old or an 8-year-old child.
And do you recommend patching in between these orthoptic exercises or only orthoptic?
Actually, patching, I was following patching for all the children with amblyopia. So I still don't discontinue. But sometimes it is very expensive for 15 rupees a patch every day. So then this is better.
Okay.
But it was a magic and a miracle for both of them. And where on OCT, we had that there is definitely a functional disorganization in retina. We can see on OCT. But we never thought that he would improve so much. his vision would improve so much, the child. And there are now all these children who come, they are very happy that their vision has also improved and squints are decreasing. And it is a non-invasive procedure, so they are more happy. Especially in this 30-year-old dentist, he was a literate person, an adult, so he could tell all his symptoms very well. Earlier, the children could not understand and we had to measure it, either vision or stereopsis or the squint. And we had to convince the patient that really it has decreased. You have to identify from first photographs and initial treatment and now. We had to tell them. But for this adult, we were very happy because he himself could tell the difference between before starting the treatment and after the treatment.
Did you do OCTs in these patients?
Madam, yes, we have done OCT in this patient who is a 6-year-old child.
Only that particular patient, not others?
No, not others, because here the fundus itself was a pathological fundus. But other patients' fundus is normal, so we've not done OCT for other patients. Because OCT, they say, even if there is regeneration of the photoreceptor cell, or if the degeneration decreases and restores some vision, but still it will not be seen on the OCT as a structural or a, you know, anatomical increase in size. So we are not doing OCT.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Please go ahead.
But ERG and PEP may show increase in spikes in the amplitude, definitely.
So ERG was done? ERGs were done?
No, ERG is not available in my town. I'm in Sonapur. So we'll have to send the patient away.
Okay.
Yes, but now we've collected few, and for them we've decided that we will at least do VEP, which is available, and then we can show the results on VEP.
Okay, right. So maybe that you can get a connection with those things also if you get those.
Yes, definitely. Right.
Okay, thank you, Reshma madam.
Yes, thank you, sir.
Thank you. Actually, we are running a little late. We have one more speaker. Initially, she was not there. Whether she's there or Sarita Kagde. Dr. Sarita, she's there. Are you there?
I don't see her here, sir.
Okay, so far we have 5 speakers only. So shall we conclude?
Yes, sir.
Dr. Sumiti, have you contacted? Are you sure she is not there? Dr. Sarita Kagde?
Sir, I suppose yesterday she had said yes, but now she is not reachable. She is not available. So we need to move on.
Okay. I would like to say thanks to our judges. Dr. Pankaj, sir, it was a nice session. Dr. Praveena, ma'am, thank you so much.